All right. Hello, I am Christian Stevenson with the Mississippi State University Extension Service here in Hancock County, joining you for another presentation by Zoom. And if you're watching on YouTube, thank you for joining us that way. If you are watching on YouTube, I do encourage you to go down and hit the subscribe button. That will let you know when we've got new videos uploaded. Try to do two of these a week. And if you'd like notices about when these programs are going to be live, then I would encourage you that right here on this page is my email address and the phone number for my office. So whichever way is most convenient for you to contact me, go ahead and do that. And I'll make sure that I get you on the distribution list to let you know when we're going to be hosting these presentations. So today we're going to be talking about composting. Composting is a really interesting process and a great way to improve some of our gardening efforts. So we're going to talk a little bit about what's going on in composting and how to make sure that our backyard compost is going to be successful. So just to start off, to define what compost is, compost is just partially decomposed plant material that is mixed with soil. So we have all of the garden waste and things that we might have, or kitchen waste, and we're mixing that with soil and allowing it to break down into a product that's going to be really valuable for us in the garden. Compost has a lot of organic matter in it, all of that plant material. And because of that organic matter, it can improve the structure of our soil, add some nutrients that are really valuable for plant growth, and affect the benefit, the water and nutrient holding capacity of our soil. And we can just mix that directly into our garden soil. We can use it as a mulch material on top of the soil. And then we can just mix that in with the soil after the growing season. And one of the great things about compost is compost never goes bad. It's easy to handle, and you can store it essentially forever and continue to use it in the landscape. So, you know, the best benefit of compost is using it as a way to, again, improve the structure of our soil, the tilth of our soil. We call those kinds of material soil conditioners. Again, it's going to increase water holding capacity. A lot of us here in the Southeast United States, we tend to have either a heavy clay soil or a really sandy soil. And whichever of those situations you have, adding in organic matter is going to improve the structure of that soil. It will either break up those clay soils and allow water to infiltrate a lot easier, or it'll bind together those sandy soils and allow and improve its ability to hold water. All of those compost materials additionally have a lot of nitrogen and phosphorus and potassium, not to mention all of the micronutrients that plants require. And so as we're adding compost into the soil, we're additionally adding in a lot of those nutrients. What's more, those nutrients are in an organic form. If you think back to the presentation that we did where I talked about different kinds of fertilizers, then, you know, when a nutrient is in an organic form, it's in a kind of larger, more complicated chemical. It's going to take longer to break down. And so as it breaks down really slowly, it releases those available nutrients into the soil slowly. And so as water moves through the soil, it's less likely to be able to leach out those nutrients, which makes it available to the plant for a longer period of time. There are also a lot of environmental benefits to composting. We do want to take care of our planet. And a lot of what we generate in terms of waste in our homes, particularly in our landscapes and in our kitchens, are organic waste materials that instead of going into a landfill, could be composted to produce soil for our gardens. So about 30% of what does go into landfills are things like grass clippings or yard waste. And of course, that takes up space in landfills, which has a cost along with it. And not only that, you know, one of the things I'm often being asked, you know, what's going to be the best thing to add into my soil? And so we're losing a free resource that we could use to improve our gardens. There is a U.S. Composting Council, and it estimates that about 67% of what goes into a landfill properly could be composted in order to produce good soil and you know, slow down those filling up of those landfills. So it is a really good, ecologically sensible, and environmentally safe way to use those materials. And it, you know, one thing I like to think about is the concept of sustainability. And when we talk about sustainability, we talk about, you know, protecting the environment, saving money, and being socially responsible. And composting is an activity that really meets all of those three requirements as a sustainable practice. So now we know why. So now we want to think about what, you know, how is composting, you know, what is going on in the process of composting? And so composting really is just the management of the natural decomposition process for organic matter. It's going on, you know, if you've ever walked through a forest and looked down at the ground, you know, all those leaves and other organic matter that fall down on the ground are essentially slowly breaking down and returning those nutrients into the soil. So what we're doing in composting is just the same thing. We're just doing it in a managed way, in a smaller space, and trying to speed it up a little bit in order to make it a little bit more efficient for us. And so what, you know, what goes on in that process involves all of those organic waste materials. And then the microorganisms, largely microorganisms that are responsible for all of that decomposition, and then the oxygen and the moisture that those microorganisms are going to need in order to grow and to accomplish that purpose. So for compost to form, it needs to go through a heating cycle, or what we're going to call a thermophilic cycle. And that thermophilic cycle is driven by the decomposition microorganisms that are living in that compost. And that process is going to take some time for compost to go all the way through this process of decomposition. It may take 6 months. It may take more, dependent on a lot of factors going on in that compost. But the more efficient we are, the better we manage the compost, the faster that process is going to work. So here's just a little chart that talks about the four different phases of compost. We're gonna start off, and that compost is going to be just at the same temperature that the environment is. So whatever the temperature is outside, that's the temperature that the compost is going to be at. And so we first get into this mesophilic stage, where you have temperatures around 95 degrees or so. And as we're getting into that stage, as that process is starting, there is a really rapid buildup of the bacterial population inside that compost as they begin feeding on all of the material in that compost pile. As the process continues, those populations increase. We get to the thermophilic stage. Thermophilic just literally means it loves heat. The temperatures for the thermophilic stage can get up as high as about 160 degrees Fahrenheit. And that's a really good thing. You know, on a cold day, you can actually see steam coming off of a really active compost pile. As that temperature is going up, it affects the composition of the microorganisms that are active in that compost, includes a lot of bacteria and fungi and actinomycetes. So we're going to talk a little bit more about those different groups of organisms here in just a minute. And then as those populations begin to exhaust their food sources, the temperature is going to start to drop again. And you get into a second mesophilic stage in that 95 to about 113 degree range. The bacteria have exhausted their food source. Populations of organisms in there are gonna drop down. And as the compost completes, it's going to end up back at the ambient temperatures in the environment, just the temperature it is outside, whatever that happens to be. So let's talk a little bit about some of the different organisms that are involved in the process of composting. And bacteria, the smallest organisms out there, are going to make up the vast, vast majority of the organisms that are involved in composting. So about 80 to 90% of all of the organisms in there, just by numbers, are going to be bacteria. And they're also responsible for a lot of the decomposition of those organic materials, as well as through the action of their metabolism, as they're feeding on things and using energy, they generate heat. And that's what's generating the heat inside that compost pile. Now, there are all sorts of different bacteria, and the different types of bacteria are going to change over time as the temperature changes inside the compost pile. So you have bacteria that you can look at that are kind of rod-shaped, and you can see a picture up there. The top picture shows rod-shaped bacteria. You have some sphere-shaped bacteria, even some ones that are spiral-shaped. And you start off at the very beginning, you have a lot of the same kinds of bacteria that you would find in topsoil. That's not surprising. That's where a lot of our compost material came from. So we would expect to see a lot of the different, a lot of the same bacteria. Then as the temperature begins to increase, you start to see bacteria that really favor those really high temperature environments. Things like the bacillus type of bacteria, you might be familiar with that from some biological controls or some pesticides that we use. There's even a genus of bacteria that lives at really high temperatures called the Thermus genus that really, really likes high temperatures. As the temperature gets up really, really high, as we start to get up to 120, 130, 140 degrees, I have 60 Celsius there because I always start off in Celsius and I have to translate. We wind up, you know, those bacillus bacteria can actually survive by kind of walling themselves off in a little spore environment. So they start to predominate again as the temperature drops. But these are good bacteria that are helping with the breakdown of those organic materials in the compost. Actinomycetes are a really interesting group of organisms. They are a kind of bacteria, but unlike sort of the rest of the bacteria, they form little filaments where they have multiple cells all in little lines. If you're not familiar with them by looking down a microscope, you're familiar with them if you've ever worked out in your garden, that earthy smell that you have when you're, you know, when you're turning earth, things like that, is produced by actinomycetes. So they're really important in the breakdown of really complex organic materials. So cell wall materials in plants are made up of cellulose and lignin, which are long, complex carbon compounds. And these actinomycetes are able to break them down where a lot of other organisms are not able to. So you start to see some of these, you see them in the thermophilic phase, but you also see them as at the ending process, as that compost begins to cool. And so at the end of the composting process, you might see these sort of white threads, you know, kind of branching threads in the compost. And that just tells you that these actinomycetes are doing their job. Of course, very important are fungi. And they, again, are really important for decomposition of all sorts of different plant polymers like cellulose and lignin. And you know, they're sort of, you know, operating on a slightly bigger scale, so they can break down those materials. And then as they break them down into smaller pieces, the bacteria can get at them to continue that decomposition activity. And any material that might be too dry or too acidic, too low in nitrogen, the fungi can attack that, break that down, and then make it available for the bacteria. So there are all sorts of fungi out there that are what we call saprophytes. They feed on this decaying material, and there are just all sorts of them. And you'll generally see these, particularly in the outer layer of the compost, once the temperatures start to go up. Now we also get some larger organisms in our compost as well. So we're going to talk about some of the invertebrates that that you'll see showing up in compost. And I also, I get asked about, you know, some of these pretty often. So we'll address some things about that. Of the invertebrates, probably the most common are going to be nematodes. You're not going to be able to see these by eye in most cases. The vast majority of nematodes are microscopic. They're tiny little worms that live in the soil. And a lot of times we hear about nematodes because there are some nematodes that are pest organisms. But in most cases, they're beneficial. They're doing exactly what they need to do in the soil. And they're very effective as physical decomposers. So they're attacking those larger materials in the compost. There are millions of them present, and they feed on decaying plant material, break that down, and again, make that accessible to the other, or, you know, the small, the microorganisms that continue that process in the compost. Of course, a little bit, you know, with better reputation, earthworms are really important in compost as well. They do a lot of the work for the larger decomposers, tunneling in through the soil and feeding on dead plant matter. And that tunneling is really important for aeration. It allows air and it allows movement of water through the compost pile. So just their movement and their feeding turns that compost pile and helps it stay active. There are going to be a lot of mites that get into compost. Oftentimes they will hitch a ride on other organisms that come into the compost. The vast, again, really, really small, so you usually need a magnifying glass to see most of these. And they feed primarily on organic debris, but there are some that are predators of nematodes or insect eggs. We do get insects in our compost. And oftentimes I get phone calls about people, you know, I've got beetles in my compost, or I have, you know, flies in my compost, things like that. Probably the most common insect that you might see in compost is going to be what's called a springtail. These are members of an insect order called the Calimbula. And what they have, they call them springtails because they have a little extension on the end of their body. And when they feel threatened, they will pop that, and it allows them to kind of jump up into the air, so they got the name springtails. And they feed on decomposing plants and pollen and fungi and grains, things like that, but they're also helping that process of decomposition through their action. Oftentimes, you'll see these as just tiny little specks, tend to be kind of pale white or really pale tan color. On a much larger scale, we do get some beetles in compost. In a lot of cases, what we get are these insects called rove beetles. You can see a picture of that down on the bottom there. And they are kind of fast-moving, predaceous insects. They feed on insects primarily. So, you know, they're not really hurting anything, but they are just feeding on insects. We also get some other beetles, like ground beetles or featherwing beetles, that actually feed on the fungi and decaying plant matter in the compost. Something I do get called about frequently is ant beds starting off in the compost. That can be a little bit of a nuisance because nobody wants to have to deal with fire ant bed in their compost pile. But ants can actually be really beneficial to our compost. They're feeding on all sorts of things. But they also bring in fungi, they bring other organisms, so they're turning nutrients through that compost and helping accumulate a little bit of phosphorus and potassium. So their movement through the compost can be beneficial. And if you have a problem with ants, you know, just make sure that your moisture level for your compost is right, because at that higher moisture level, the ants are not going to be really comfortable. And you do need to be turning your compost on a regular basis, and the process of turning your compost will disturb them, and they won't want to hang out in there anymore. Earwigs, going down to the bottom there, earwigs are another common insect. They're really distinctive. They have kind of a flattened body, But the really distinctive thing for earwigs are those two kind of pincher-like things on the back. It's not really a pincher. And they're absolutely harmless to people. And they primarily will feed on decaying vegetation. There are some that are predators of insects as well. Now, I do very frequently get called with people saying, you know, they've got flies in their compost. And I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. The flies are a great way for good bacteria to be introduced to your compost pile. So those bacteria that are necessary for the process of compost forming and processing and going through that heating stage can catch a ride into the compost pile on one of these flies. Occasionally, of course, they will lay their eggs in the compost, and that will come out as you know, an immature fly. We call a maggot. A lot of people don't have a really positive association with that word, but those maggots are really good. You know, they feed on some bacteria, but they also feed on decaying material, and they turn over compost and do other good things. And as the compost gets up to a high temperature, they're not going to be able to survive in the compost and will go away. So all that's going on in your compost, let's talk about how we can build our compost pile in the first place. And you don't have to have a compost bin. You can just have a pile. That's perfectly fine. Having it enclosed like that really is an aesthetic thing as much as it is for the benefit of the compost process. So you can just build it on open ground, or you can make a bin out of cinder block or board or wire fence. Any of those materials are working just fine. But you don't want the sides of the bin to be either air or watertight. You want to be able to allow air into the compost. And you really want water to be able to move through it as well, because you don't want water to accumulate too much in that compost. So we can start off just by spreading a layer of organic matter about 6 inches deep in the area where we're going to start our pile. And generally, it's a good idea to add in a mixed fertilizer, something like a 6-8-8 if you can find it. But if you can't, an 8-8-8 fertilizer is just fine. And add just about a cup of that to every 10 square feet of your compost pile. Over that, you can add an inch of just your native soil and a little bit of water to moisten it down. What we're aiming for is about 40 to 50% water. And then you just repeat this process, and you repeat this over and over until your compost pile is as high as you would like to manage it. And so this just gives you a sort of visual idea of what's going on. You have a layer of organic matter, a layer of soil, and a layer of fertilizer, and you stack it up forward, and that's what it might look like actually on the ground. It doesn't have to be contained in anything. A pile will work just fine. There's your graphic that's a little bit better in terms of showing you your layer of organic matter and fertilizer and soil moving up and up. All of that's going to get integrated together as it composts and as you turn the compost pile. Here's some examples where they have them contained. Again, doesn't have to be anything fancy. So old pallets or chicken wire is perfectly fine as a way to enclose one of these compost piles. And that, you know, material is really going to allow, it's going to allow water to escape. It's going to allow air in so that compost pile stays healthy. Sometimes people do like to have what they call a three-stage compost bin. In that, what we do is we have one stage where we've started the compost process. So our fresh material goes into one side, accumulates and starts that process of composting down. As it starts to break down, we move it over into the second stage where it's going to work and go through that thermophilic process. And then at the end, we have our finished compost. So the start is really kind of a bin for our new materials as they're getting ready to get composted. The middle is our working compost that's actively going through those heating stages. And then finally, we have a place to store our finished compost before we use it out in the landscape. Here, backwards is another example. So this goes from right to left, just to be a little awkward. And you can see they have those starting materials where they're kind of bulky. And as they break down and as they're working, you can see you've got a good loss of mass there as that organic matter is breaking down. And then the finished compost there on the far left. Now, there are some other forms of composting that are just a little bit different and maybe a little bit more suitable for different roles. One of these is trench composting. And it's just what it sounds like. You're going to be composting in a trench. And to do that, you just dig a trench that's 8 to 12 inches right there in the garden space. And you put your kitchen waste and your organic materials, cut them up really good so that they're in small particles. And you're just burying them in that trench, covering them over with leaves or grass clippings, cover them over with soil. And that just allows them to kind of slowly break down in that trench. And then you don't really have to do anything to move that compost out into your soil. You're just going to alternate locations for that trench throughout your garden space. And that will improve the soil in those areas of the garden as those materials break down and naturally integrate in with your soil. On a little bit larger scale, there's what we call sheet composting. And in this, it's a really good practice if you've got a lot of organic material to work with, and really if you want to start a new area as a garden and improve that soil for a garden that you're going to put in. So down at the bottom, you can see sort of the finished process there where they're going to have two stretches of garden. At the top, they're in the middle getting started, and they've got a big square or rectangular area that they're going to be using the sheet composting method on. So you want to mow that area down as well as you can. Add those grass clippings right back onto it. Add a nitrogen fertilizer if you need to. And then we're going to put a really thick layer of newsprint or a thick layer of cardboard over that entire area. That's going to form a barrier for the soil. The grass is not going to be able to get any sunlight, so it's going to die off and compost right there in the soil, along with that newsprint or newspaper and corrugated cardboard. And over the top of that, you want to put about 3 inches of shredded leaves or compost or manure, and that's going to form the base for your compost. Over that, about 6 inches of other garden trimmings like kitchen scraps, chopped leaves, or straw. Water that thoroughly. That's all going to settle down after you pile it up, down to about 6 inches. And over time, that is going to break down. Earthworms are going to come up in there and break down a lot of those materials, be drawn to that as a food source. Now, this process is going to take some time. If all of the conditions are just right, then it might take 6 months to really turn all of this into a good composted soil. But in a lot of situations, it might take anywhere from 9 months to a year for all of this material to compost. But it does produce a really great area in the soil there. As a great way to start a new location for a garden. So what's the materials that we put into our compost is going to be really important. We want to make sure that we're providing the right food sources for all of those microorganisms to keep that process of composting going. And so really the two things that we're considering really important for this is the amount of carbon that goes into the compost and the amount of nitrogen that goes into the compost. So carbon you can think of as the energy or the gasoline that the microbial population needs. Nitrogen is all of the building blocks that they need to build their cells and everything like that. So we need not only these elements, we need them in the right ratio for those microorganisms. What we're aiming at is a ratio of around 25 to 1 or 30 to 1 carbon to nitrogen in order to get the right ratio for the microorganisms. So we can divide materials that go into our compost into two big categories. So we have brown materials that tend to be brown and have a lot of carbon, but not very much nitrogen. And then we have green materials that tend to have a lot, high amount of nitrogen, but low carbon. So brown materials would be things like leaves or newspaper or cardboard, dry grass clippings, things like that. Where green materials are going to be fresh grass clippings, still have a lot of green material in them. Fruit and vegetable waste from our kitchens, livestock manure, tea bags, coffee grounds, all of those fall into that high nitrogen category. So here is a little bit more broadly, a variety of different materials that you might see added into compost and the percent carbon and percent nitrogen that make up those materials. And then really importantly, the carbon to nitrogen ratio, which is really kind of the business end that we want to look at. So keeping in mind that we want to maintain around a 25 to 30 ratio of carbon to nitrogen, you can see that yard and kitchen waste really does have almost the right ratio that we're looking for. It's a little shy of the amount of carbon that we would like to be adding in. So we might want to add something like leaves or straw as a way to bulk up that, that carbon ratio to get to right at what we're aiming at. The other kind of side of this is if you start with a material that's really high in carbon, and a lot of the material that we have that we could compost tends to have a ratio of a lot more carbon than we need. And so we need to supplement the amount of nitrogen. And so there are some materials that we can add, like fish scraps or soybean meal, things like that, or just nitrogen fertilizers that allow us to get that right ratio. And I do often get asked, how am I going to figure out exactly what this ratio is? And that can be really difficult to do without doing a whole bunch of really complicated math. And so I don't want you to get too focused on this, but I do want you to keep in mind as you're adding different materials in, kind of keep in mind, is this going to be a really good carbon source or really good nitrogen source? Is this a brown material or a green material? And if your compost isn't active, the ratio of those materials can be really important, can be something that we need to address in order to keep this going on. Another thing that can happen is just because we have carbon and nitrogen there, doesn't necessarily mean that it's in a form that the microbes can use. So sometimes we need to kind of adjust those carbon and nitrogen ratios depending on how available those materials are. So the most difficult molecule in a plant for the microorganisms to break down is called lignin. And it's present in the cell wall of plants. It's a really tough material. And as it breaks down, it makes a lot of other carbon molecules available to it. So we may need to add in some extra material just to make up for the fact that some of that carbon is not accessible to the microbes that we have. At the same time, if we add in a nitrogen fertilizer, sometimes we wind up adding in too much. And as a response to that, we might wind up losing some of that nitrogen through either leaching out as water moves through the compost, or it may evaporate off. In fact, if your compost tends to have a little bit of an ammonia smell to it, that is going to be related to nitrogen leaving the compost. So if we're adding in materials that are high in carbon, like leaves, we might have to add in some additional nitrogen to get that C and N to ratio into its optimal range. And we might want to try to, as much as we can, use some organic nitrogen sources, because those are going to break down a lot more comparably to the growth rate of microorganisms. And if we are adding a nitrogen fertilizer, adding it slowly and in a series of applications rather than all at once, is that's going to more closely model how those natural nitrogen sources would decompose and kind of match the growth of the microbial population in the compost. Again, if you got a lot of ammonia smell, that can indicate that there's just too much nitrogen there. Now, we don't often think about the pH of our compost. Of course, pH is a measure of the acidity or alkalinity of our soil. Anything below a 7 is considered acidic. Anything below 7 is acidic. Anything above that is alkaline. And the vast majority of the compost materials we're putting in are slightly acidic. And as the microbes work, they build up all sorts of organic acids. But those are good for the development of fungi. They help with the breakdown of those complex carbon compounds. And as the process of composting finishes out, that pH of the compost is going to neutralize somewhere between, somewhere between 6 and 7.5 or 6 and 8. So we're going to wind up with a relatively pH neutral material, which is great for us because, we can easily work with that in the garden. We don't want to add any lime to our compost because lime will react with other things that are going on in there. And that will do what we call volatilize some of that nitrogen and allow some of that to leave as ammonia, which can just evaporate off into the air. We just, allow that pH to be kind of down. Your pH of your compost as it's working should be kind of acidic. And then as it finishes off, it's going to become more neutral. We do want to make sure that we have our materials in our compost broken down as much as possible before we put them in. As we have smaller waste particles, there's something called the square cube law or the area to volume ratio. As we increase the surface area of a particle, as its surface gets bigger, its volume is going to increase much, much more. So if you have a 1-inch cube, it has a volume of 1, but if you have a 2-inch cube, it has a volume of 8. So quite a big difference there. All of those bacteria need to be able to get access to that material. So having that bigger surface area in relation to volume is going to allow those microorganisms to work on it a lot faster. So you can see just kind of the curve there. As we have a 1-inch diameter, it's going to be able to raise in temperature much more quickly. It starts working a lot faster. If we go down to 2 inches, that's going to significantly affect it. If we go all the way to 6 inches in diameter, it's going to be really difficult for that decomposition process to go on. And so sometimes, you'll see a compost pile that has a whole tomato plant that's been thrown in there. And that tomato plant will just, it seems like it sticks around forever. It's just too big of a material for those microorganisms to be able to get to and break down. So as much as possible, we need to shred or grind or chip up those materials going into our compost. If we have to mow and bag those materials, that'll be a great way to handle things like grass clippings or leaves. And particularly harder materials like brush or tree limbs, you want to chip those into small pieces before they go into the compost. Now, there are some things that you at least want to be warned about in terms of things you might want to consider not adding to your compost. I break some of these rules pretty often, some a little bit less. Diseased plant material, you want to be really cautious of that. If you've got a plant that had a serious fungal or bacterial problem, the process of heating that in the compost may not completely kill off all of that disease organism. So you can wind up reintroducing it out into your garden area, which is not something we want to do. At the same time, if you have weeds that have started to produce seeds, those seeds can survive through that heating process, and you may be introducing those back out in the garden as well. If you have preserved wood, maybe don't chip that up. Most of our modern wood products are okay, but some treated wood, you don't want to necessarily put that into your compost bin. Probably the rule that I honor most in the breach is adding in things like meat scraps. Bones take forever to break down, so I don't tend to add those. But you do want to be aware that if you add any meat products or animal products into your compost, while they will absolutely break down, they may attract animals to the compost bin that'll wind up digging things up, and that can be a little bit of a nuisance. You do want to turn your compost bin on a regular basis. I recommend every 14 days just to make sure that you're allowing oxygen to get down into the compost bin and making sure that those microorganisms all have all of the air that they need. That's going to speed up that composting process and help that those populations grow so that all that active compost continues. You also want to make sure that your compost has the right moisture level. The optimum for microbial activity is around 50% moisture by weight. And as it dries out, the process of decomposition will slow. If it gets to 15% moisture, decomposition will essentially stop. So it may be necessary to add water to the compost if it's been particularly dry and hot. At the same time, we don't want our compost to get waterlogged. We don't want too much water because as all of that water is in the compost, we're pushing out all of the air. So all of the oxygen is leaving that compost environment. And what will happen then is the different kinds of bacteria will start to proliferate, will get more common in the compost. And unlike the good bacteria that are in your compost, those bacteria that can grow without oxygen, we call them anaerobic bacteria, tend to generate kind of a foul smell. So a good way that you can kind of indicate that, one, you might need to turn your compost or your compost might have too much water, is if it has a bad smell, that's not what it should smell like. It should just smell like dirt. So turning your compost and checking that water level is really important if you have a bad smell. So 50% water by weight is a little bit hard to estimate. Sometimes we can do that by what we're putting into the compost. So things like food waste, yard waste tend to have pretty high amounts of water. So you need to add in a little bulk material like sawdust or cardboard because they're pretty dry, and that will lower the water content down to what we need. If you have it at the right level, there's a formal way to test that where you dry out the material, you weigh it wet, and you weigh it dry after you've dried it in an oven, and you work out the weight of the material that way. That's maybe a little bit too involved for most backyard composters. So really the easiest way to do it is if you can pick up some of your compost and squeeze it as hard as you can and just have a tiny amount of water drip out of that, that's going to tell you that it's right about the level of moisture that you need. It should feel about like a wrung out sponge. So we all kind of know that feeling from doing the dishes, and that's about the feel that you're looking for. Now finished compost is going to be ready to use, if it's gone through that that heating process. Once it gets back down to ambient temperature, it is ready to use. It's going to have a really dark, kind of crumbly appearance, really good fresh, earthy smell. And again, that process can take 6 months, 9 months, dependent on the materials that you're working with. But it's an excellent material for use in the home landscape. You can integrate that material directly into your soil, adding in good organic matter, adding in nutrients that the plants are going to need. You can also use compost as a mulch around your gardens, adding that to the top of the soil and integrating it in over time that way, and protecting your plants and adding in a great mulch layer as well as benefiting your soil. So I appreciate your attention. I do want to take a second here at the end of the presentation. Information for this year's Master Gardener program has been released, and I want to make sure everyone's aware of it. This year for 2021, the Master Gardener training for Mississippi will be entirely online. If you're not familiar with the Master Gardener program, as part of the Master Gardener program, you get access to 40 hours of in-class instruction on a wide range of different topics related to horticulture, gardening, and natural resources. We start off talking about basic botany and, you know, naming plants and the way that plants work. You'll get information on all sorts of different types of gardening for ornamentals, fruits, vegetables, lawns, managing insects and disease in the home landscape. All sorts of other things like that. So really interesting course for you. You know, good for people who are brand new at gardening, good for people who have had a lot of experience as well. I manage to pick something up every year when we go through the program again. In addition to that, you also become a member. You can, if you're here in Mississippi, become a member of the Master Gardener Association for your county. And there are, you know, a lot of other people who are interested in horticulture that are really doing some great volunteer programming in the community. So you can connect with other people who are interested in horticulture, do some great things for your community while you're doing that. So you can register for that starting on the 1st of March, which is coming up very quickly. That's Monday. Register anywhere from March 1st all the way to April 15th. The course is going to open up at the start of May and continue on to have access to that through the 30th of June. And so I'd really encourage you to be a part of that if you're not already. And if you have questions about that here in Hancock County, of course, you can contact me at this email address or by that phone number. Or contact your county extension office wherever you are. Having it online means even if you're listening from another state, you can participate. Really encourage you to do that if you're not already a member. So thank you very much. Appreciate it. Again, if you're on YouTube, you've made it all the way to the end. If you have any questions, please feel free to just write those as a comment right there in the YouTube video. I will see that and be able to come back and answer your question. So thank you for attending once again, and have a wonderful weekend.